enhance LiDAR performance using classical and quantum time frequency correlations. Professor Helmy is a professor in the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of Toronto. He has led a long, productive career in both industry and academia, on both sides of the Atlantic. First at Glasgow for his master's and PhD work on integrated photonics, then at Agilent Technologies for his work on monolithically integrated optoelectronic circuits, and now most recently at Toronto with his focus on quantum LiDAR. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Helmy.
Thank you also very much for making it and for the opportunity to come and talk to you all. It's such a wonderful place for this work and related activities, if you like. Very notable achievements that were done in this very campus by lots of distinguished individuals here. So it's such a pleasure to be here today. Given the background of campus, I can't just talk about quantum LiDAR. I'm gonna have to also talk about some of the semiconductor devices that we do that end up making this LiDAR deployable and somewhat quantum, but deployable in the field. That stuff is like in some sort of a suitcase that you can go and take and look at things outside. In comparison to some of the slightly more maybe rigorous topography or tomography based LiDARs that you would really truly have to have on an optical table in your lab. So before I start, I would like to acknowledge the people that actually did the work. And I'm sure the graduate students of you here will realize or appreciate that. So much of the work was done by the top echelon, which are the students, Han, Ryan, Payam, and Dongpong, as well as more recently Bilal and Philip Blakey. The postdocs are in the sort of line below: Aaron, Brodich, Daniel, Zizhong. And some of the very initial work about 7-8 years ago, when my group started to get into the entangled state work, was carried out at the University of Waterloo, which is about 1.5 hours from Toronto, in an established group for doing tomography in quantum states by Gregor Weiss, who's now in Innsbruck, and Thomas Yenavine, who's still there. Some of the phase-sensitive amplifier work was done in collaboration and through some funding from Fujitsu Labs of America. So the talk generally, the outline looks something like this. I'm gonna provide you with a bit of an introduction for why on earth would someone pursue quantum and sensing together. The sexiest work out there is for quantum and comms, and quantum and maybe metrology, and quantum and compute, right? I'm sure you're all familiar with that. But why are there interesting problems that quantum can readily address, but they're more in the sensing space rather than in these other domains? And then after that introduction, I'm gonna speak initially, given the background of the campus and its clout in the field, about the semiconductor devices that we use to generate the sources. In fact, historically, my group did not start by studying LiDAR right off the bat. We started actually by generating relatively high flux, or very high flux, I would say, chip-based, effectively laser pointer type entangled sources. So these are semiconductor chips in a butterfly mount that you can put a battery to, and you get an entangled state with a concurrence of about 98%. For those of us who are not familiar with the topic, that just means that the entangled state that comes out has got high fidelity if you compare it to a perfect entangled state, about 98 or 99%. So right off the bat, from a semiconductor chip without any other devices or an optical table, that enables applications. When we started looking at applications, for us, it appeared that sensing would be the most suitable one. And then I'll speak about one modality of a quantum enhanced LiDAR. Other ones exist within the group portfolio, but I will not have time to speak about today. So by way of introduction, but at the same time also motivation, why would we be interested in some sort of a target detection scheme that does not use classical light versus quantum light? And there comes a very important hypothesis. The entangled LiDAR that I will speak to you about today only gives you an advantage, but a formidable advantage, if you compare it with classical LiDAR with the same photon flux. Oops. Why is that a problem? Because the existing LiDARs right now would launch 50 milliwatts, right? 20 milliwatts out to look at for autonomous vehicles. But when we compare these LiDARs with the LiDARs that we work with, we take this intensity down by 9-10 orders of magnitude, so we can compare on a flux by flux basis. So these modalities of entanglement-based or enhanced LiDARs only work, just so we understand, if you are constrained in the photon flux. If you have no constraints in the amount of power or the flux that you have, and you can get your signal-to-noise ratio close to infinity, then there is no need for any quantumness in the system. Are we all familiar with what's SNR, signal-to-noise ratio? Good. So, what are some of these applications where we would like to solve such problems? Autonomous cars work great in a place like this campus, for example, where the density of cars per unit area is usually less than one, right? If you go to a game up in Michigan or in Chicago, the density of cars around the stadium will be significantly larger than one. In this case, every single one of these autonomous vehicles, assuming that the autonomous vehicles will be pervasive in the future as they project to be, then there will be a significant noise-related issue when you have 1,000 of these on the same square. So noise resilience, in this case, without having to use CDMA or some of the classical techniques that require digital signal processing, DSP, that's when optics could be useful, because then you can reduce the photon flux for every one of these LiDARs to sort of photon level, single photon level, and deploy quantum techniques and sources, so then you can get them all to work in unison without interfering with one another. So that's one example. What other examples? Another example is bioimaging. Functional bioimaging, where we would like to be able to look at tissues and identify some of their abnormality or normality or some of their attributes through their interaction with photons, inelastic scattering like Raman, luminescence, or any other technique that helps us, or OCT, in fact. I mean, we've been doing OCT modalities with incredible fidelity. That is an extremely exciting domain of characterization of biological tissue. But if you'd like to look at the eye, at the retina, at the brain, where one has to still be alive, ideally speaking, you cannot afford to actually cook that part of the brain by virtue of putting a femtosecond laser on it and getting multiphoton absorption. That is also one modality where one would require low photon flux on the single photon level for one to be able to do this, so effectively without touching the sample, but also without damaging the sample. So these are only two examples where there is an actual demand out there for imaging that is limited in its power budget. So it's not completely fictitious. There is another one which actually funds me, which is basically security-based, where governments would like to be able to do this in a clandestine fashion against jamming. This is good old radar, but at this point in time, we do in the optical domain. However, maybe slightly less academic, but the first two are very much so. But then this is the pull from the market. How about capabilities? Well, it turns out that entangled sources in quantum light and processing of non-classical light has been booming over the last 10 years. We've been generating a plethora of entangled state, being able to entangle in almost every single degree of freedom. We've been able to do these on chips that predominantly, apart from this work, have been optically pumped. But then at this day and age, with heterogeneous integration, you can couple in a fiber with ease. And we've been also having incredible advances in the detection of single photons. So the ecosystem is there to be able to do enable these two things to meet: the demand, the pull, and the push, which is the devices and the capabilities. So I'll speak to you about a platform that we've been developed. Actually, it was the very first project that I worked on when I moved from industry to academia at the University of Toronto. And for us to be able to understand the attractiveness or the attributes of that platform, let's try to remember for the uninitiated. For the initiated, sorry to bore you, but for the uninitiated, what does it take to have a relatively bright, effective source of entangled light that is either pulsed or CW that is not on demand, basically sort of a flux, not on demand? We need a nonlinear process, and this could be any type of nonlinearity that you prefer. And through that, you need to be able to inflict or to implement parametric processes. And with that to be present, you need to be able to pump it. You need the power supply to be able to have input photons to enable these parametric processes. And at the end of the day, for us to be able to shape the state, the quantum state itself, we also need some engineering to the structure, its refractive indices, group indices, dispersion and group velocity mismatch between the interacting waves. relatively simple ingredients for those of us who work in photonics, actually. But the challenge to have these in one chip that is also battery operated is not so easy. Ultimately speaking, in concert, these can provide us with interesting entangled sources. Our approach in the group is that we use relatively standard semiconductor technology that we can go and grow on one continent, fabricate in another continent, and package in even a third one. This was something that was I worked on maybe in 2004, 2005, and so it was even patented and still valid up till now. But then the applications themselves have been bearing fruit, partially due to fab actually, only in the past 5-6 years or so. So these devices look like so. They look like VCSELs. Any of us know about what VCSELs are? Actually, one of the most famous VCSEL guys is sitting in the room. So VCSELs are vertical cavity lasers where light itself is actually guided in a core depicted in green here, but not through total internal reflection, instead through Bragg reflection. And the emission usually of VCSELs in the vertical direction. However, instead we're going to actually operate this device in the longitudinal direction, and in concert we're going to add another waveguide concocted with that waveguide that is based on conventional total internal reflection. So now you have more than one waveguide in the same structure, sharing a common core. Why is that useful? Because through analytical design, you can actually get the photons that you pump the system with, like the pump photon, for example, as well as the quantum light photons that will take place because of the nonlinearity in the green region, to be engineered at will analytically using no numerical techniques with closed form formulas. So that gives us a very powerful approach to be able to engineer the entangled state, which is gonna be parametric light signal and idler for those of us who are familiar in either through Chi2 or Chi3, relatively accurately. So that's one advantage of these structures, of the edge sort of emitter, or if you like, type of VCSEL. One other very important approach that is a key ingredient that one needs in this is to be able to control the dispersion. There are tons of techniques to control the dispersion. But controlling the dispersion in a guided wave system without having significant scattering. Because one of the most obvious ways to control dispersion is to put a grating, right? Put a grating in the structure, work on the band edge, et cetera, and you can control dispersion. The challenge with doing things in that fashion is that this grating, if not near perfection, ends up capturing a lot of light, and the loss goes up by a significant amount. Anyone who works in quantum will appreciate that quantum states are extremely fragile, and they really don't work very well with loss. But it turns out this edge-emitting vertical VCSEL, through controlling that these Bragg stacks, you can extremely exquisitely control the dispersion. You can make it very large positive beta 2, you can make it large negative beta 2, you can make it zero. These tricks are now played routinely in the silicon photonics, if you like, landscape, to be able to generate like comb sources and utilize Chi3, etc., etc. So carrying this out or obtaining this in a laser structure without any periodic modulation along the direction of propagation, the modulation is actually across the field. The field does not see any periodic along the direction of propagation, can be quite powerful. So with all these ingredients together, we could do things two ways. We can actually have optical pumping where we can actually pump the light source or the power source from outside, and with it, one of the parametric light ingredients, and with that we can actually get maybe the other parametric light out, or we can get parametric gain like I will show you, etc., etc., and that's called the optical pumping variant. Or we can do the other exciting option whereby we can have quantum wells in the core, the green core that I described to you before, and these you can dope the structure and the quantum well will end up emitting coherent radiation that is red here depicted with lambda pump, and this coherent radiation is just nothing but a laser diode, right? An edge-emitting VCSEL, that's what it is. But because the structure has all the ingredients that I spoke to you about, dispersion control and GVD and GVM control, you can get, or you can design in, that the signal either come out entangled in several degrees of freedom. We've worked on frequency entanglement, time bin entanglement, polarization entanglement, among others. Again, this would happen in one chip with no filters. Why is it important not to have filters? It's because of the flux. If you end up removing some of the fiber out, it's very sort of rudimentary, right? If you remove part of the spectrum out because you're trying to achieve a certain correlation, you're removing some of the power that you can use. But if you do all that during the generation process, it all fits within the mode or the structure that you like. So a few examples. One obvious example is the very simple frequency conversion, because that's a parametric process. You basically inject that particular laser with current from a battery, and you inject the signal light. In this case, this pair, this group of frequencies, what comes out is the complement pair at different, complement frequencies. This is basically frequency conversion across a double the pump. The pump in this case will be 780 or so, and double it will be around 1560 or 1570. So across that sort of center, you can actually convert the frequencies. So the frequency conversion efficiency in these laser diodes is particularly high in comparison to other approaches, if you will, unless you compare it with lithium niobate. It's difficult to compete with lithium niobate because the loss is orders of magnitude smaller, and you can make significantly longer structures. Semiconductors are not necessarily known to be extremely low loss, so then usually it works well if these devices are less than a millimeter or so. So the efficiency is not bad at all. However, the exciting part is that we're doing this in gallium arsenide. Gallium arsenide, it turns out, to be extremely transparent all the way to 12, 13 microns before phonon absorption kicks in. So the fact that you can do this frequency conversion means you can actually do it also in very interesting parts of the spectrum. Around two to three microns, 3 to 5 microns, and between 7 and 9 microns. 7 and 9 is really important for explosive detection. 3 to 5 is important for combustion analysis and fire detection, etc., etc. That would all be achieved using one chip. This work is not of great value, to be frank with you. Why? Because it competes with extremely powerful sources, QCLs. So it's very difficult for you to have these devices emit any power close to what QCLs would provide. So with respect to the frequency conversion, simple vanilla frequency conversion would not be of great value to, I guess, what's needed in the community. But here is something that is of great value and relatively unique. It turns out that these devices, as part of the parametric processes that are in there, they can provide gain. So if you can have a signal that goes into the structure depicted by this vector in blue, it will have the magnitude and the direction of the vector itself, but the amount of noise itself will end up being the radius of the sphere. Any amplifier in any degree of freedom, any part of the spectrum, RF, etc., ends up having it's called phase-sensitive amplifier, ends up amplifying the signal to any degree, but it increases the sphere. It increases the sphere and it remains a sphere. If we end up having an amplifier where we can actually make it coherent, it ends up amplifying the signal, but the sphere itself no longer looks like a sphere. It can be evolved into an ellipsoid. Why? Because you can select, depending on the phase difference between the interacting waves, which one of the quadratures would actually be enhanced in noise extra, more than this radius, and the other one gets the noise magnitude reduced less than this radius. So in extreme measures, you can make this, what's the extreme, what's ultimately what we're looking for? A straight line, right? You would like 1 degree of freedom to have no noise. This has been actually a holy grail for the community, believe it or not, in optical communications. So there are entire groups in NTT in Japan trying to make something like this happen. Why? Because one of the biggest impediments in optical comms right now is not loss, it's not dispersion. Most of that can be done even using DSP, let alone optical things. It's the noise and the accumulation of noise as a function of amplifiers. So if you can have an amplifier that doesn't give you the standard quantum limit of 3 dB, where you cannot do anything better than doubling the noise, you'd win. So we ended up designing one of these devices and pumped it optically in this case, not electrically, with femtosecond pulses. The device itself, physically, we could not handle less than a millimeter in length because it was easier for us. The students in the group had shaky hands at that time. They're not malnourished anymore and they actually can keep a steady hand, but still it's a little difficult. So we kept the 1 millimeter, but what we did is that we chose the pump itself to be extremely short. And when you change the length of the pump by virtue of the walk-off between the waves, you can actually effectively make the amplifier effective length as you wish. if you have this pump to be 100 picoseconds, the interacting waves and the pump will walk together until the end of the device. And the interaction and the length of the amplifier will be the whole 1 mil. If you make these pulses extremely short, there will be a walk-off between the interacting wave and the effective amplifier length would be really short. So we chose the shortest we can get before pulse breakup, because the pulse can break up, and that's 100 femtosecond. And we ended up cranking up the power supply, the pump intensity, to see what happens to the parametric wave that goes in. What comes out actually comes out with a gain of 30 dBs. So bloody what? It's 30 dBs. But it turns out, in this case, the effective device length is 50 microns. We could not leave 50 microns, but the walk-off tells you that this gain interaction only resides in the first 50 microns of the device. After that, all the waves involved in this interaction actually walk off of each other. The pump walks along and does not overlap with the signal. So that's why the gain of about 30 dBs in 50 microns is a record. It remains a record. But a gain number, as a gain number, is not so big. There are optical fibers that can provide you with a gain of 70 dBs. But their noise figure is 11 dBs. So why do we get a gain of positive 30 and negative 30? This is where the phase sensitivity comes in. So if one prepares the state that goes into our device that is right there, and prepares it such as the pump and the signal you're trying to amplify are out of phase, but coherent, then this is a phase-sensitive amplifier with a phase angle of pi. In this case, you have this scenario, the very large one. In this case, you have amplification, but the noise is larger than the classical limit. But if you have the gain, the pump and the signal, both in phase, both coherent, the gain itself ends up being positive, and in this case, you choose the narrower ellipsoid dimension where you can push the noise to be below the standard quantum limit. That's why, and then, you get, obviously, you can get everything in the middle filled by changing the angle between the signal and the pump, right? Any mismatch in the angle from zero to pi will give you all this. These are the extremities. Right? So the gain sounded pretty cool, large per unit length, and the fact that you can get it to be a phase-sensitive amplifier where it gives you the same gain up and down is also encouraging. The calculation of the mismatch in walk-off to give you an effective length is right here. As you increase the pump, you can actually get that effective length to go down to 50 microns. So the effective device length, 50 microns. Let's take a look at the case of everything is in phase, so zero phase mismatch between them, and let's calculate the noise. Here is the noise measured. Here are the noise measurements in red, and the error bars are also in red. It turns out, it actually took us about a year to publish this measurement, if not more, because at the highest gain of about 28-30 dB, we were getting a noise figure of minus 2 dBs. So what does that mean in physics? It doesn't mean anything, right? You cannot get a gain of minus, so you're basically denoising your signal as it goes through, right? So we did this measurement many, many times, and it turned out to be really, really 0.2, minus 0.2. But it turns out, through going every single piece of instrumentation and calibrating it, that we have one of the instruments, if you like, the optical spectrum analyzer on which we characterize this, has got a finite sensitivity and rejection ratio, if you will, that it can reject all but 0.2% of the spontaneous emission. So this residual 0.2% can actually turn out in the measurement to give you erroneous noise figure. And when you remove it, when you remove the 0.2B, like the leakage basically that's going through the OSA, it turns out that these measurements give us an amplifier that provides not only 28 to 30 dB gain, but it gives you virtually unmeasured noise. I'm sure if we have a metrology lab that has a very elaborate setup to characterize noise, we'll be able to get a finite number above one. But given the setup that we were working in, we could not distinguish it from zero. In fact, we had to do calibration to actually see that it is zero, not negative. So that was very exciting for the individuals that were funding this, who are Fujitsu here, actually not here, but in Dallas. But then what made it very exciting for us from a quantum perspective is that if you look at the sensitivity, which is basically the noise equivalent power of this, how low of a flux can this device handle? If you end up cranking the power lower and lower and lower and looking for that 30 dB gain, it turns out the device can work down to 0.05 photons per second. So it can actually detect a single photon that does not even come in with every pulse. So its sensitivity means it can have huge advantages for quantum applications as well. And we're pursuing that right now. But again, that just shows, goes to show you, if you have a powerful device with nonlinearities, dispersion engineering in the same, on the same chip, you can do cool things with it. So these are all classical examples. At the beginning, when we pursued this device or this platform, we were not particularly interested in classical, because we know that classical, as I mentioned, would compete with quantum cascade lasers, which gives about two orders of magnitude more power than this. It was quantum that we're interested in. So the parametric process that we spoke about is depicted here for TE and TM, where if you come with a power supply pump depicted in the x-axis, the signal on either your parametric light, entangled or not, depending on what you do in the dispersion, is depicted with these two curves. So what can one do with these? One of the things that we could do is that we could design the structure to have an overlap between the two curves. And that overlap means that within the same, with the same pulse, you can generate this entangled, this parametric light, the one with red, and the one with black. So in this region, if you filter out this region, which photon will it be? You don't know, they're indistinguishable. And distinguishability is a requirement for entanglement. So you actually end up, through polarization, get them out to be entangled, but not get them out to be entangled normally, you get them out to be entangled with relatively large bandwidth. So if you look at the entanglement metric, the figure of merit of how entangled this is one of many, if you like, metrics, you will find that the pairs of photons come out close to 100% entangled within the C band, and that extends to the L and the S as well. So about 90 nanometers. For applications in quantum communications, for example, in QKD, you could still utilize entangled sources up until they're 90% entangled. Once they go below that, the quantumness, if you like, will render the protocols of the QKD not as effective, not as secure. But that just shows you that within tens of nanometers, these sources can remain entangled yet non-degenerate. So what else can we do? So we can actually do this not through optical pumping, we can do it through electrical pumping. So we can inject light, generate the laser light at lambda pump, and then through the engineering of the structure, we can get the signal on either. In this case, we could tune through temperature and current the pump wavelength. Why? Because if you tune the pump wavelength, you can end up getting the following. You can end up getting an entangled state, and its flux ends up scaling with the input battery power or optical power. It's important to see that curve, because that curve tells you there is linear dependence between the optical power supply power you put in versus the entangled flux that comes out. Why? Because for us to use these in useful quantum routines, you want them to be pure pairs. If this dependence is sublinear and you start to get saturation, or like sublinear or superlinear, that means you're getting multiple pairs. And that, in effect, reduces the efficacy of whichever routine you're using, be it sensing or QKD or anything else. If you look at the tomography of this particular state, you will find that it is approximately 98% with 98% fidelity to the Bell state, which is HVVH. This is basically the degree of freedom of entanglement for those of us who are not familiar with the jargon. So that's nothing but a temperature controlled laser diode pumped by a battery. In this case, I actually even have the dimensions of the battery. Zachary has worked on. The battery was 62 millimeter by 25. He thought it was important to actually accurately mention the dimension of the cavity, the battery in comparison to the laser itself, because the laser itself is 250 micron by 500 micron. Okay, so we've worked on, or we've discussed what the pump laser itself does, and with respect to nonlinear and parametric light. It turned out that these pump lasers themselves are actually very unconventional. The band gap of the structure looks something like this. So the grating and the active. For us to be able to phase match and utilize second order nonlinearities, we had to make the core in the middle relatively unconventional. For us to make lasers, for those of us who work in the field, we need to be able to trap not just the photon the photons in a waveguide here, but we need to be able to trap the carriers too. But in this case, we made no attempt to trap the carriers, or very little attempt, despite, except for the fact that your quantum wells have got a significantly lower band gap. So in that sense, once the carriers reach here within the diffusion length, they fall in the carriers and in the wells, but nothing else beyond this region. So it turns out that this is not a conventional way to design lasers. That, in fact, coupled with the fact that we can tune dispersion, offers us something really interesting. If one can make these devices into mode lock devices, how many of us are familiar with what is mode locking? Mode locking is a concept where one can generate many modes in a light emitting device, and one can lock their face together, and when one does that, the device itself ends up generating by itself pulses that are near transform limited without any RF necessary. So in this case, we've put the central absorber where we can get basically mode locking in the middle of the cavity, and that would give us something called harmonic mode locking. So look at the following. If we change the current, it turns out that we can actually get pulses that hold the record by a factor of 4 of the shortest pulse ever generated in a diode laser, and that was published last year. Diode lasers in this wavelength regime, which is about 780, the shortest pulse before that work was about 600-700 femtoseconds. If you move to 1550, because of the material system and the band gap and the band offsets are different, the carrier lifetime and the escape time is different. You can go up down to 500-400 femtoseconds. But look at this, the very conventional structure, but one where we can control both dispersion and the carrier escape time, you can get down to record low. So this has attracted a lot of attention from lots of people that are not the usual players, if you like, because eventually what can that do? How many of us are familiar with titanium sapphire lasers? Okay, titanium sapphire lasers are lasers that emit around 780, and their use is immense, and getting you 100 femtosecond pulses with about 50 milliwatts of power from these can do tons of damage, I mean tons of applications. So we're relatively close. If you can get this halved, or maybe if you can get 60, 70 femtosecond with 50 milliamps, which is, or 50 milliwatts, which is a very modest amount for diode lasers, you can effectively replace a good chunk of titanium sapphire lasers. But it turns out we're not really interested, actually, in the short pulse alone. We don't care. The short pulse here comes with a repetition rate that is commensurate with the cavity length, right? Cavity lengths of diode lasers are approximately on the order of a few hundred microns. So the rep rate here was 40 gigs, 60 gigs. So that eventually gives you interesting short pulses, but for us to do this quantum and nonlinear effects and devices inside, we need peak power. Peak power comes with short pulses, but lower rep rate as well, right? You don't want it to emit at 60 gigs. You want it to emit at 60 megs. So you could shoot the peak out power by a factor of 1,000. So we designed the device to be slightly lossy on the edges, and then we achieved something slightly cool. We actually got it to mode lock, but at the same time, we also got it to self-pulse using another technique called Q-switching. So it's Q-switching and mode locking at the same time. Why is that cool? Because the mode locking, where you have very short pulses at extremely high rep rate, is shown by the gray. But the Q switching basically works to provide an envelope that peaks up after you choose, you can choose it actually, after 100 megahertz, 50 megahertz. So so that it almost acts as a modulation for your mode lock. So then these pulses that are 130 femtosecond now, they don't happen every sort of basically 1 over 60 gigahertz, they happen 1 over 50 or 100 megahertz. So now we have a laser that emits, this is just an example, a laser that emits 2 milliwatts. When you get to operate in that mode, it has so much peak power, it burns the cavity, the facet, from 2 milliwatts. The peak power is absolutely a record, I mean, for these devices. For 2 milliwatts, you can get 10 watts of peak power. 2 milliwatts is nothing for a diode laser. If you crank the power up and design it to achieve peak power, you can basically emulate.
What's the wavelength there?
Oscillator, 785.
785.
Okay, so I think I would like to at least use the remaining 10 minutes to speak about entanglement and LiDAR. Do I have more than that? I think it's 10 minutes is reasonable, right? Or anybody keeping the time? Okay, I'll order dinner then. Let's continue.
Plenty of time.
Thank you. Okay, so there are plenty of modalities of sensing in the quantum world. Many of them are extremely accurate, particularly when used for metrology, because they can provide you with exquisite information. However, dealing with entangled states ends up requiring extremely low loss, extremely high phase coherence amongst all the interacting waves. So I'll tell you about one of the least demanding, most promising approaches that has been developed in the quantum world, and it's called quantum illumination. Quantum illumination is a concept that was proposed by Seth Lloyd in MIT and verified by Jeff Shapiro also in MIT. And I'm actually quoting Jeff's paper because it's the practical implementation and it carries the spirit of the arguments that I would like to make. What this approach is that it replaces coherent states, which is laser light, with an entangled state and uses that entangled state to get the photons thereof to impinge on a target and then receive some of it back and compare it with the existing reference that they have, and they do tomography in both, and based on that characterization they can obtain information about the target. It's a brilliant routine. This protocol is really important because it's very noise resilient and it's also loss resilient. It's just a matter of if it's lossy you might have to wait more until you get enough signal noise ratio accumulated. So it's an extremely promising approach, and there's tons of work on it. But here is the first implementation to it. This is an optical table, as you will notice. Some of the aspects are in fiber, some of the aspects are in free space. But the single most important attribute here that I'd like you to note, that for this to work, is every single one of these waves has to be phase coherent. They need to all be coherent with one another, and they need to be aligned within much less than a wavelength. Needless to say, for this to work, the target, I need to know where it is within a fraction of a wavelength of light. And it needs to be stable within a fraction of a wavelength of light. So it's a wonderful routine for metrology, but it becomes quite difficult for practical LiDAR. And from that, we're going to basically move forward to try to have equally impacting approaches, but not as restrictive. That has been our thesis, if you will. Ideally speaking, LiDAR works like this. You get either a laser state, a coherent state, or in this case, an entangled state. You retain one photon as your reference. It's almost like doing homodyne. You retain one like for a reference, and then you get the other entangled pair out to impinge on a target, and you characterize its attributes. Ideally speaking, if you'd like to have an experiment, you would like to have a measured source of loss and a measured calibrated source of noise as well, so you can investigate the impact of these routines through increasing the noise and the loss. The groups in MIT, what they end up doing is that when they get the photons at the output, they end up doing full tomography, which takes quite a while, and it requires phase coherence with everything. Is there another approach to this? Can we do something different that is not as restrictive? Well, it turns out the quantum states have tons of correlations. You don't always have to do the full tomography. For example, So basically, a continuous variable type, spontaneous parametric down conversion state like the one that we've been discussing ends up having the two photons in the entangled photon pairs get generated almost simultaneously. And the detection time of each one of these is random, effectively. The correlation between them, this, which is called the joint temporal intensity distribution, that correlates what happens to the either after knowing the pump, can be engineered. In this case, it looks like a very, very sharp ellipse, but depending on the dispersion, you can change this. So this correlation can depend on your source of entanglement. That, and it's all right, because this can be made arbitrarily sharp, could be used as a filtering mechanism instead of the tomography. How would it be used as a filtering mechanism? You know exactly what happens or when TI either will happen or will take place as you characterize TP. So you have a temporal filter by knowing the temporal correlations. Let's dig into this a little bit more. QI, quantum illumination, it basically characterizes the time and frequency entanglement. So it simultaneously measures time and frequency, it does tomography, and it's intrinsically phase sensitive because it requires, it is based on SFG, but it also requires quantum memory because you're waiting for one photon to go impinge on the target and come back. So in this case, that's the mechanism. You take your backscattered signal from the LiDAR and your reference, and you put them into a nonlinear crystal to carry out the effective tomography. The one that we started with does not need that, and you can just basically look at temporal correlations. So when you look at temporal correlations, you can actually do independent measurement of the signal of the idler, and they do not need to be in any way, shape, or form phase coherent. So that helps, but it has a huge problem. The problem is it competes with noise not so favorably, because if you have noise photons, you will not distinguish them, and they can get your detector to be saturated. Because remember, we're talking about a single photon space. So if you're having a signal either coming at the same time and you're detecting them at the same time, you may well have noise photons coming also at the same time, completely randomly. But if I can crack the noise up by 10 orders of magnitude, statistically speaking, there will be enough noise photons within the band of the signal either to saturate the detector. So I will not be able to measure the signal. Is there something we can do about this? We can actually have, instead of just temporal correlations or frequency correlations or any correlations on their own, we can add another layer of quantumness. In this case, what we chose is a nonlocal effect. Nonlocal effects take place on quantum states even remotely. So the photons that we generate are entangled in time and frequency. So the blue photons, the ones in higher energy, are, and the red ones are created at the same times. So both of them, they see the same delay as one another. And because of the time frequency entanglement, if you end up dispersing one positively and dispersing the other one negatively, they will still interact and correlate, and this time function will still be, yeah, that's a non-local effect. And it will only happen for an entangled photon. If you do this for coherent states, a laser light, noise light, it doesn't work. And that's why it is a quantum effect. In fact, for those of us who are mathematically inclined, this very much is a fractional Fourier transform problem, if you're familiar with what that is. The preservation of correlation can be understood as that, a fractional Fourier transform. So the time evolution evolves in the x quadrature. So if Fourier pair is what? It's basically time frequency in different quadratures, right? Yeah, so fractional transform, Fourier transform is actually a state in the middle between, the not 90 degrees, there's actually an angle in between that is not 90 degrees. So just as time evolution evolves in one quadrature, to a peak quadrature, the eigenstate of the oscillator itself, the dispersion, cancellation of both evolves in a time eigenstate to a frequency, degree of freedom. So this is how one can understand it, if you will. So let me tell you what we've done in the cell. So we built a model LiDAR system, or we had the light impinging on the target 5 meters away, and then we have a detector. But then the photons that we generate, the entangled light, has a signal on either,
that look exactly the same. The path where we sent the signal out to impinge on a LiDAR, on a drone in this case, or a target, actually has measured loss and measured noise. So if we go and see the spectrum after the measured loss, you will find that the probe light now has less light because it incurred loss. If we go after the second stage, you will find that now we have a noise signal that even supersedes your probe. That's a signal, that's a negative signal to noise ratio, right? That's a negative SNR. But what you do now, you take the reference and you pass it through one sign of dispersion, and you take that ensemble, the green and the red, and you pass that through another path, another sign of dispersion. They will expand in time because they are short pulses. You've dispersed it, right? One will go impinge on the target and the other one will be kept as a reference. At the outcome, when you end up basically look at the coincidences, the signal coincidences don't change. Look, the blue stays the same magnitude. But after you do the dispersion, instead of the noise being very similar to the signal, it will actually end up being dispersed. I'm not sure, I mean, I know that there is a radar institute here, but I'm not sure how many of us are familiar with the notion of spread spectrum. It's a very electrical engineering concept of radar. Spread spectrum is a technique that has been used about 70 years ago and won the West the war because one would be able to actually spread the noise while being able to retrieve and spread the signal, but have a correlation or a code or frequency or time hopping. There are different ways to do this to retrieve the signal back again. This is the exact quantum mechanical analog of spread spectrum. If you want to see this in the joint spectral amplitude, you will find that without dispersion, this is the signal and this is the noise. The signal is slightly more focused on the noise. If you end up having a filter to get that signal out, you will still get a chunk of the noise, right? Because this one is slightly more dispersed than that, but not by much. But if I end up doing dispersion in two directions, and I end up actually getting the signal either by virtue of the quantum correlations to interact, that's the entanglement function. So then if you filter in time, you remove most of your noise and you leave only the ones in band. If you compare the performance with classical light, the entire experiment has been leading to negative SNR, minus 20. Meaning that the noise is 100 times more than your signal, so you cannot make it up. The exact same setup, remove the laser state, put the entangled state, the SNR became about 43, so 50,000 times more, 43 dB, than your negative SNR, and actually it became positive. This is an effect that depends on quantumness. If you actually change the time window, the filter window, the effect enhanced. If you also on the same axis, but I don't have it plotted, I think, but if you also reduce the power of the entangled light, if you reduce the power of the entangled light, the effect will also be enhanced. Why? Because as you actually reduce the pair rate in the entangled source, the fidelity of the state, the quantumness, becomes higher. So that effect of filtering becomes improved. A more visual way of looking at this is if you have a target, these are three reflectors in space. Each one of them is actually a little tilted, so you'll be able to see a range, right? Each one of them is tilted with an angle, they're not straight, and they're at different distances from the source. If you try to see them with noise and classical light, for a certain amount, with no noise, you could see them. With some noise and classical light, you cannot make them out. If you do the same with quantum, and the nonlocal effects, you can still make out the U of T, but if you put 25 dB of noise, you can still, with either a glass of wine or some DSP, you can make out still the U of T. There are lots of things related to radar, sort of, if you like, metrics. So there is a radar metric that I will not dwell on. It's called receiver operating characteristic. It basically just tells you what is the detection probability of your target as a function of the false alarm. So in just plain English, where do you want to be? You want to have the highest detection probability to be close to one, but you also want the false alarm to be as close as possible to zero. So you want to be somewhere here. So if you use classical light, as you reduce the false the false alarm probability, the detection probability goes down exponentially. This is an exponential. For the quantum light, it only goes down by a factor of two, or like by 40%. That's a manifestation of the same effect of being able to very effectively filter by using non-local effects. This system is completely you can retrofit a classical LiDAR to this. There is nothing here that is so special, so quantum, except the source itself and two detectors instead of one. No phase coherence, no nonlinear processes. It's extremely vanilla. But it turns out, if you do the exact same LiDAR, but with continuous wavelength, for those of us who appreciate what radar is, it's basically time of flight. I have a very accurate pulse. I know exactly when I sent it out, and I time it until it comes back, and that time is twice the distance, right? So most of the work in LiDAR right now actually tries to develop lasers with very small jitter, because it's this time accuracy that is important, and the detection jitter as well. Look at this. This is the same experiment, but with CW light. So this is nothing but like, you know, the CRT, you're all too young, including you, to understand what's a CRT screen. But screen, very old TVs, not the ones that you, the flicker noise that you see, and electrons basically illuminating that screen, is what we send out. That's what we see on the screen. But look, when you get 50,000 times down with the CW light, no pulsing, I can actually tell exactly where the target is. I can actually do ranging with CW. And this is the holy grail, this is where we got funded. Because that does not look like anything. It's a random signal that nobody can see an adversary. And if you can't see it, and you're just randomly jamming it, it's also Andy jamming with like 45 or whatever dB. But look, it can actually accurately determine the position without any pulses, because of the time correlations existing in the entangled state. Could do that. The devices that we implement have this control and dispersion. When you have that control and dispersion on your SPDC process, the entangled light, you can get the photons to come out with a correlation as short as 10 femtoseconds, like 2-3 optical cycles. So you can have an accuracy that is immaculate, more than anything that a classical jitter can do or a classical detector can do. It's baked into the correlation, the quantum states that are generated together. In the interest of time and your tummy and lunch, I'm just gonna skip this part, where we do this in two dimensions, if you will. And I'll skip that recently, although we were able to discuss with you how we got 43 dB of enhancement, we actually started to use other things related to LiDAR, and we were able to do not 43 dB, but 109 dB. So we could see in negative SNR, where the signal is 11 orders of magnitude smaller than the noise. So you basically have the signal somewhere here, and you keep going down and down and down until the noise, and you keep doing that for 11 orders of magnitude. Nothing about this is extremely phase sensitive or loss sensitive, but the noise resilience is formidable. I mean, this is probably another talk on its own right, but I just wanted to maybe get these and hopefully in the future you'll read about it. Thank you so much for coming, I appreciate it.
Very amazing talk. I'm not even sure where to start, but one question is, in all of this, you're using essentially the quantumness to really improve your measurement. What is the sort of flux of photons that you have when you're getting that?
About 10 to the 8 photons per second.
conventional off-the-shelf, conventional off-the-shelf entangled photon sources end up having 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6. There are places, certainly like Paul's group, et cetera, et cetera. If you can tweak the state more, you can get more flux. Actually, the record is from the, unfortunately, late Yaron Silberberg in Weizmann Institute, in using Piplin, where he can have, I think, hundreds of nanowatts of in a Piplin crystal. But this, nobody achieved that. But and in that case, actually, the entanglement itself was not characterized. But the holy grail is to go above 10 to the 10. And we think we have work being baked in the oven right now to achieve that and then some more. Because once you have that amount of flux, you compete with slightly more realistic LiDARs, and you can also go the distance. The distance idea is actually a perennial problem, because generally speaking, anything quantum will still be within that 10 to the 10.
So that curve you showed where you're looking at distance, the issue is the farther you go,
the more you lose, right? There's R squared loss because of the fraction, right? So we could make it farther and farther, and you can understand the people who are funding us want it to be much farther than 5 meters in the lab, but there are ways around this. Actually,
thank you. I owe you lunch, Ken. Thank you. You know, this actually,
no, we owe you lunch.
This result is actually not using quantum effects. It's using quantum-inspired approaches, using the exact same techniques, but classical light. And the power of that is that it can give you more noise resilience, but this system was implemented with 10 milliwatts. So we're preparing to see 1 kilometer.
If you can push 100 dB,
there is room for more, trust me. But the key now is we're not trying to push this more than 110 that we got. We're trying to push the distance. We want to achieve this.
Yeah,
exactly. We want to achieve this at a couple of kilometers. That's I think this would be the real advance, rather than trying to increase this more and more.
So how does beam combining come into this?
Yes. So you end up actually combining in various degrees of freedom. Because the thing is, in quantum, you cannot pump harder. Remember I showed you the linearity of the entangled source? It has to stay like that for the approach to be useful, for the state to be pure. Because the purer the state, the better the effect between classical and quantum. So you have to stay with a group of sources that are pumped at a low level. So combining, but not just in spatial degrees of freedom and others as well, is the approach. Yeah, the whole high power laser sort of portfolio, you could borrow a lot of things from that. Mm-hmm. But it has to be compatible with quantum.
Yes.
Thank you for a great talk.
Of course.
I was just wondering, when you are using entangled sources, you will have an uncertainty in time whether you get a pair of entangled photons or because it's an SPDC source.
Absolutely.
So does it affect your results?
Not really, because eventually you would have, your name is?
Shweta
is asking, because that's a random process, you don't have certainty of when these come out, right? So it's a fair question, very fair question. So what we end up doing, Shweta, is that we actually work them or build the device to be large enough so we can pump it hard enough. So even if there is an uncertainty, the uncertainty comes at a time window that is very short. Like maybe in this case, it will be over femtoseconds where you have a finite probability of not having any photons. There will always be some. Maybe it will fluctuate, but there will always be finite amount. That's how you solve that problem.
Thank you.
Of course.
In terms of your platform, you're using gallium arsenide based materials and using down conversion and recently there's been some work in out of Santa Barbara where they're looking at aluminum arsenide and looking at nonlinear down conversion effects in that. So from the point of view of that perspective in terms of making waveguides, do they have the same, how would you compare that approach?
It's an extremely powerful approach. They have not, to my knowledge, implemented any phase matching.
Yeah,
they just basically look at the nonlinearity.
Right.
But I don't have access to it. If I have access to something like that, I know exactly what to do. There is tons of opportunities because you could combine the low-loss approaches and techniques on silicon and you can couple it directly to these elements that you can make to be very efficient as well. So it, very powerful.
I guess what I was asking about is the comparison between the, you were describing your quantum well, essentially, your active region.
Yes.
Where you engineer dispersion for your down conversion, and then you drop a quantum well right at the right energy.
Yeah.
And I was gonna compare that to a bulk aluminum arsenide waveguide, you know, certain length or whatever. I'm not sure how they're
but would there be electrical injection there or no?
I guess it's optical pumping, is it?
Yeah. It's optically pumping, so it's a little different.
Yeah. Good point.
But again, even if it's optically pumping, there is, had one been privy or had access to basically such a platform, you could then develop it to be electrically injected, and you can end up actually coupling it to low loss circuits to further either distill, you can do distillation for the quantum state, or you can do all sorts of things, send it out and bring it back on the low loss system, right? Because this system is fantastic for the source, or maybe the detector, but the processing, you cannot do it there because it's too lossy. Like if you would like to split, if you would like
right, yeah, that's free space. Yeah, you get anything you put in, it's gonna drop.
For us, we do it in fiber, but yeah. But very powerful indeed. Any more? Lunch is calling, I think.
Thank your speaker again.
Thank you.